to the crimson unsearchable tide. Kneel down on the shore, you thirsty no more. Go under and be purified. Follow Christ to the holy mountain. A sinner sorry and wrecked by the fall. Cleanse your heart and your soul. In a river that flowed for you and for me and for all. On that wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful stand of this night, you and me, where tonight is gone forever, washed white on that beautiful, scandalous night.
Yes.
On the hillside you will be forgiven.
Yes, that's right.
At the point of the cross justified. And your spirit restored by the will of the Lord, from our blessed Savior's side. On that wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night,
this time. Rachel Stafford is going to sing for us. May the Lord bless her.
What I could have done to Well, it's good tonight to have Pastor Johnson speaking for us in this service tonight. Let's just give our undivided attention to him. And let's pray that God will just help us tonight. He knows exactly what we need. Brother Johnson, the Lord bless you.
Thank you, Brother Mowry, and thank you, Rachel, for that beautiful song. Wasn't that wonderful? Amen. She reminded us of the sacrifice of Christ and how unworthy that we are. But thank the Lord that he loved us enough. He died for us. Amen. Drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love we owe. Your Lord, I give myself away. It's all that I can do. And in response of what Christ has done for us, let's give our lives completely to him. Amen. Thank you so much for that tonight. Both songs seem like went along with the season, the passion of Christ, the crucifixion of Christ. Yet tonight, I don't feel any leading in that direction. I like to preach according to the calendar, the Christian calendar. As a pastor, I always did. But as I sought the face of the Lord for this service, I just felt directed to speak to you tonight on something different than that. And so I invite you to turn with me to Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 6. Let's stand together as we look at his word. Acts chapter 6, beginning with verse number 8. Let me say thank you to the young people who moved up.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Mary asked for volunteers to move up. Thank you for the young people and those of you that did not and should have. Shame on you. Amen. I mean that. Thank you, young people, for moving up and giving space to those that are coming in a little later. There's plenty of room on the front, brother. Right here, too. Acts chapter 6, beginning with verse number 8. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of the Libertines, the Cyrenians, the Alexandrians, and of them of Cilicia and of Asia, disputing with Stephen. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. Then they suborned men, that is, they induced men to commit perjury. That's what that word means. They suborned men which said, "We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God." And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes and came upon him and caught him and brought him to the council and set up false witnesses which said, "This man ceaseth not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us." And all that sat in the council looking steadfastly on him, that is on Stephen, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. I want to talk to you tonight upon this subject, the devoted deacon. Stephen, the devoted deacon. Father, we stand in need of your help once again tonight. And we pray for your anointing that only comes from you, that you would give us the words to say and help us, Lord, to speak in the power of your Holy Spirit. Not by anything that we have done, not by our works, Lord, not by us, but by you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. It was in the spring of 1989. UBC Days was going on at Union Bible College, and Brother Hodel got up and preached a message that I'll never forget. As soon as that message was over, I made a beeline to the tape man and bought a tape that same day. And once or twice a year, I listen to that tape and rejoice the message that he preached that morning. In that message, he gave something that I have never forgotten. It has made a tremendous impact on my life. And I have it on my desk underneath the glass top where I can see it every time I sit at my desk. There it is. It's not a poem. I guess you would call it a saying. But it's entitled, "My Commitment as a Christian." It was written by a young African national pastor. This is what he wrote. I'm a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I have Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I've stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I'm a disciple of his. I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense. My future is secure. I'm finished and done with low living, sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tamed visions, mundane talking, cheap living, and dwarfed goals. I no longer need preeminence, prosperity, position, promotions, plaudits, or popularity. I don't have to be right, first, tops, recognized, praised, regarded, or rewarded. I now live by faith, lean on his presence, walk by patience, lift by prayer, and labor by his power. My face is set, my gate is fast, my goal is heaven, my road is narrow, my way is rough, my companions are few, but my guide is reliable and my mission is clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice, hesitate in the presence of the adversary, negotiate at the table of the enemy, ponder at the pool of popularity, or meander in the maze of mediocrity. I won't give up, shut up, let up until I've stayed up, stored up, prayed up, paid up, and preached up for the cause of Christ. I'm a disciple of Jesus. I must go till he comes, give till I drop, preach till all men know, and work until he stops me. And when he comes for me, he will have no problem recognizing me. My banner will be clear. I say hallelujah to that. And although that was written by a young African pastor, it could have been written by Stephen, for it sums up the very essence of his life. If any word would describe Stephen besides the word full, because it's given time and time again in here, he was full of faith, full of wisdom, full of the Holy Ghost. And so besides that word, if any word could describe him, I believe it would be the word committed. He was the devoted deacon. I would love to pastor someone like that. I'd like to have someone like Stephen sitting on my church board. I'd like to have someone like him that I could pastor. But sadly, we live in a day of commitment crisis. It's hard to find truly committed Christians these days. Those that are really committed to prayer meeting. Amen. Not just the Wednesday night service, but how about the 5:30 prayer time? Oh, I appreciated the presence of God that was felt there today as we gathered together and prayed. But I can't help but look around and wonder why some aren't there. Everybody okay? How about revival services? Well, Pastor Johnson, you don't understand. I got my kids trained. They're in bed by 7:30. Somebody tell me how you do that. Because we just can't get it done around the Johnson household. My kids, they're in bed by 7:30. I've got them trained. 8 o'clock, they're in bed. I can't come to revival. Friends, you can't afford not to come to revival. You know, sometimes I would love to crawl in people's brain and just see what they're thinking. I might be surprised and wish I hadn't done it after I got there. I don't know what people think. I wonder if they think, well, the preacher and the board gets together, fills up a jar of evangelist names, kind of trolls around, picks one, R.G. Humble. Okay, let's call him. And, you know, and revival is just another thing we have. And friends, I don't know about you, but I didn't treat revival that way as a pastor. And I know our pastor doesn't. I agonized. I labored. I prayed every revival. I preached a series of sermons on revival, leading to the revival, trying to prepare my people's hearts, and agonized and prayed and wept. And then revival comes, and those that stand up and say they love Jesus with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, you don't find them there till Saturday. If you're lucky. So it's hard to find truly committed Christians to prayer meeting, revival services, committed to tithing, Sunday school, working for the church, whatever it might be. It's getting harder to find committed people. Talk to any pastor, they'll tell you the same thing. In a lot of places, church attendance is up, and that's good, but fewer and fewer of them are 100% committed to the cause of Christ. I just finished a book last month that literally was one of the greatest books I've ever read. Chuck Colson wrote a book entitled Being the Body. I recommend that book to everyone. He says that the crisis is seen in the fact, listen to what he says, that a lot of churchgoers' mindset is all about consumerism. In other words, what's in it for me? A lot of people don't pick a church on where can I go and be a blessing? Where can I go and help out? Where can I go and find ministry, something that fits my goal, my goals and my gifts? Instead, they look around and say, what's in it for me? What does this church have to offer me? Instead of asking, what can I offer this church? It's all about consumerism. He called it the McChurch mentality. It's a quarter pounder one day. If you don't like that, you go to Wendy's the next. If you don't like that, go to Chick-fil-A. The McChurch mentality. The church becomes another retail outlet. Faith is just another commodity. People change churches as readily as they change banks, grocery stores, or health clubs. The point is to go where you can come away feeling good about your investment. Spiritual consumers are not interested in what the church stands for, but in the fulfillment that it can deliver to them. Is that not selfishness? Is not the essence of sin and carnality self? Even if self's on a higher level, it's still selfishness. So the result is an age, what Colson says, mix them, match them, salad bar spirituality. In today's consumer culture, what many are looking for is a spiritual social club, an institution that offers social relationships, but does not make authentic demands as to what they believe or how they should live. But friends, the Bible, God's Word, still clearly tells us how we are to live, how we are to act, in what way we are to live. And this is why it's so refreshing to come across the life of Stephen, a man that was committed to God, committed to God's work and God's cause. He wasn't even a preacher. He was a deacon. He was a board member. That's what he was. But he was 100% sold out to God and to his cause. So let's examine together his life of commitment. The first thing I notice is the splendor of Stephen. The splendor of Stephen. There is one word that is used over and over again, chapter 6 and 7, that describes Stephen. It's the word full. I noticed that Stephen was a spirit-filled man. Acts 6 and 5 says, and they chose Stephen, a man full of the Holy Spirit. And because he was spirit-filled, they could not resist him. According to verse number 10, they could not resist the words that he was saying. Why? Because he was a great orator? Because he knew what to say? No, it was because he was filled with the Spirit of God, and they could not resist a man that was filled with God's Spirit. He was spirit-filled. A lot of people these days are full, but they're full of self and their own agenda, their own way. But here is a man that was filled with Spirit. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but, Paul says, be filled with the Spirit, or continually be filled with the Spirit. The secret of the life of Moody was not in his education. He was not an educated man. It was not in his speech. It was not in his looks or wealth, but he was a man that was full of the Holy Spirit. Amen. He was a Spirit-filled man. Stephen was a stable man. Acts 6 and 5 goes on to say, not only was he full of the Holy Spirit, but he was a man full of faith. Of faith. He had a faith in that he believed something, and that something was the Lord Jesus Christ. He believed in him so much that he was willing to die for him. He was a stable man, full of faith. One of my favorite pictures of faith is found over in Acts chapter 27. Paul is on the ship, and the wind is awful. It's boisterous, and the waves are crashing against the sea, and they're throwing everything over, and they're saying, we're all going to die, we're all going to perish. But here stands Paul, and he says, no, listen, I believe God. And I've always pictured it this way. He's standing on the deck of the ship, and the salt water's just dripping off his beard, and everything's crashing around him. But he still says, wait a minute, I believe God. Not one of us will perish. Amen. Trust in God. God came to me this night and told me we won't perish. Oh, how we need that kind of stability, that kind of faith in these days, and this day of compromise and weak-kneed faith and all that. Oh, how we need some stability in our lives. Michael Faraday, the great scientist, was taken very seriously ill. When it became evident that he was going to die with this sickness, a group of his friends, fellow scientists, gathered around him to not really to comfort him so much, but they seemed to gather around him and talk about death. How about that for encouragement? They said, Mr. Faraday, let me ask you something. What are your speculations about the future? And he said, speculations? I have none. I'm resting on certainties. For I know in whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him. Oh, we rest on certainties. How we need that faith in our lives. Hallelujah. He was a spirit-filled man. He was a stable man. He was a strong man. Verse 8 says, and Stephen, full of faith and powers, did great wonders and miracles among the people. The divine power of God was upon him, not to exalt self, but to exalt Jesus Christ. And so he was used in bringing people to Christ. The splendor of Stephen. But as we move on out of chapter 6 and move into chapter 7, we notice the sermon of Stephen. I would encourage you to go home tonight and read the sermon of Stephen. It really, and I don't mean this critical, but it's a lot of rambling. But it's good rambling. It's anointed rambling. A lot of us haven't heard a whole lot of anointed rambling. We've just heard rambling. But here was some anointed. Man, he started from Genesis and weaved his way through. And next thing you know, they were cut to the heart with conviction. The sermon of Stephen. Notice with me the contents of the sermon. Verse 2, and he said, men and brethren, fathers, hearken. Listen to the God of glory. The contents of the sermon. The content of Stephen's sermon was about the Lord, and it was based on his word. When God called me to preach, friends, he called me to preach his word. Amen. Not my notions and not my opinions. Amen. Believe me, I have them. But he's called me to preach his word. And that's exactly what Stephen did as well. A story is told about an American Indian who attended a church service one Sunday morning. The preacher's message lacked real spiritual food, and so he made up for it by shouting and jumping and pounding the pulpit to cover up his lack of preparation. Reminds me of another story a fella had written in his notes, weak point, pound pulpit here. But as this preacher made a lot of noise and all that, and they said afterwards that he preached up quite a storm. And someone asked this Indian what he thought of the message. This is what he said. He summed it up in 6 words: high wind, big thunder, no rain. And when the scriptures are neglected, that's exactly what we have. And so when we base our preaching on God's word, then we as a people are blessed and refreshed. The contents of this sermon. But notice with me as well, I love this point, the courage of this sermon. Acts 7:51. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Ghost just like your fathers did. Wow. He didn't mince words, did he? You know, I've been praying in recent days that God would give me some holy boldness. Amen. I don't know if I want to go to this extent or not, but I've been praying, God, give me some holy boldness. I'm just going to be transparent with you tonight. Can I do that? I've been asking God to help me to witness to my family. You know what? I haven't done it yet, but I think it'd be easier for me to witness to a Muslim with an AK-47 than it is for me to witness to my dad. It's very difficult for me to share my faith with my father. Mean man. So ungodly. But in recent days, I've been praying, oh God, give me some courage. Give me some holy boldness. He's on his way to hell. Help me, Lord, to show him the way. Even if it ruins my relationship with him, I'm willing to lay that on the line to share my faith with him. The courage of the sermon. Another book that I have read, I read last year, and I liked it so much. It was actually Mr. Carter's, and I borrowed it from him. Liked it so much, I traded 3 books for this book. I've never forgave him for that because I gave up 3 good books. But we prayed about it. It's all patched up. And they're right, Brother Carter. But the book was the autobiography of Peter Cartwright. Well, you talk about interesting. Anybody ever read that? Man, I got to writing illustrations in there, marking illustrations. Finally got tired of it because my highlighter ran out. There was so much in there. But one of the greatest stories in there is when Peter Cartwright was preaching in the presence of Andrew Jackson. Peter Cartwright, by the way, was a 19th century circuit riding Methodist preacher. And he was in a town, and there was a very timid preacher on the platform with him, and he warned him that Jackson might be coming to the service, and the church house was full, and all of a sudden, as Cartwright was getting ready to deliver his message, in walks Andrew Jackson. He hadn't been president yet, but he was a famous man. He was a general. He famous in those areas. And so he walked in. There was no place to sit, so he leaned right in the back where Cartwright could see him against a post. And this timid preacher tugged on Cartwright's jacket. Cartwright turned around and said, "Jackson's here, Jackson's here, Jackson's here." And Cartwright said, "Who's Andrew Jackson? Who's he? If he doesn't repent and ask Christ to forgive him of his sins, he'll go to hell just like the heathen." This preacher behind him about died. And he made a beeline for Jackson after the service and apologized. The next day he saw Andrew Jackson outside of a diner, and Cartwright went up to him, and Jackson shook his hand. He said, "I don't know why in the world that preacher would think I'd be offended at that. Cartwright, if I had a regiment like you, I could take England." Courage. Courage. Christ-like boldness. Amen. Been a few times I wish Bill Clinton would walk in the audience. I'd give it to him. John Kerry too. Colson tells a story in this book I was referring to, along the lines of courage. He met a prominent businessman once in a city, and he was a pillar of the community. He was an active church member, but he was a very wealthy man. But he also hosted a weekly Bible study luncheon at his office. And he invited Colson to come and to attend the study and to speak. And then he wanted the people to ask questions after Colson was done. And he said it was a beautiful room. He said it was paneled on one side and rosewood. On the other side, windows overlooking the city that these men controlled. They were wealthy, affluent men. And so Colson got up and began to talk, and he said he really doesn't remember, but he referred something about sin. He said, "Actually, the words that I used was total depravity." He said, "I noticed at the times a few individuals shifted uncomfortably in their leather chairs, and sure enough, it must have hit the mark, because after I finished, the first question was on sin." The fellow said, "You really don't believe we're sinners, do you? I mean, you're too sophisticated to be one of those hell, fire, and brimstone preachers. Intelligent people don't go for that backwoods stuff." Colson said, "Yes, sir, I believe we are desperately sinful. What's inside each of us is really pretty ugly. In fact, we deserve hell and would get it if not for the sacrifice of Christ." And then this prominent leader, the man in charge, looked at Colson and said, "Well, I don't know about that. I'm a good person. I've been good all my life. I go to church. I get exhausted spending my time doing good works." Colson says the room got real quiet. He said 20 pair of eyes were trained on him. "What do you say?" Listen to what Colson said. He said, "If you believe that, sir, I hate to say this, for certainly you will never invite me back. You are, for all of your good works, further away from the kingdom than the people I work with in prison who are aware of their own sins." Talk about courage. And after that Bible study was over, Colson led that man back to his office. That man said to Colson, "Sir, I don't have what you have." And Chuck Colson said, "No, but you can have it." And he led him right there down on that plush office floor, and he wept his way to Calvary. All because of the courage of a man of God. Stephen had that courage. The content of the sermon, the courage of the sermon. Notice with me as well the conviction of the sermon. Verse 54. "And when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart." Listen, there is tremendous power in God's word. Amen. Oftentimes, I wish that I could get up and I could preach the masterpiece of a sermon. I wish that people would run to the altar. I wish all that. But really, when it comes down to it, it's not about me. It's about Him. And it's nothing that I say, but it's what He has to say. Amen. They're convicted because of God's word. I think I've shared this story before, but I share it again. I love this story. A man went to... He didn't go hear George Whitefield preach. He went to watch George Whitefield preach. And he sat up in a tree, put his hands over his ears, and he just watched the man preach. But as he was there, a little fly came by, zzz, landed on his nose. He tried to brush it away without taking his hands off his ears, but he couldn't do it. And when he took his hand off this ear and he waved the fly away, he heard Whitefield say these words, "Repent, repent, repent." And he was immediately convicted. And right there in that tree, gave his heart and life to Jesus Christ. There was power in the Word of God. The splendor of Stephen, the sermon of Stephen. Notice with me quickly and last, the stoning of Stephen. Look at what he saw in the stoning. Acts 7, 55 and 56. "But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God." Everywhere else in the New Testament, you see Christ sitting because he completed the work. And I don't know, maybe I'm reading too much into this, but I think he was standing to welcome Stephen in to heaven. Someone has said Stephen's outlook may have been bad, but his uplook was glorious. And sometimes it takes a dark outlook to make us interested in looking up. Remember Isaiah chapter 6. It was in the year that King Uzziah died, a year of turmoil, a year of things that were going bad for the people of God. It was then in the blackness that Isaiah saw God high and lifted up. And so sometimes it does take a dark outlook for us to look up. This is what he saw in the stoning. He saw Christ standing. Look at what he said in the stoning. Verse 60, "And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, 'Lord, lay not this sin to their charge.'" Of all the last words he could have said, this is what he said. He could have said, "Lord, let them have it. Send judgment. Save me." But no, he said, "Lord, do not lay this sin to their charge." Talk about Christ-likeness. For it sounds to me like the words of Christ on the cross. "Forgive them, Lord. They don't know what they're doing." What did God do for Stephen? A scoffer asked Dr. Joseph Parker. Parker replied, "He gave him power to pray over his enemies who stoned him." That's what God did for him. I don't have a whole lot of time tonight to dwell on this point, but only Christ can give us the power to truly forgive. Only Jesus can give us the power to triumph over fear and death. What he saw in the stoning, what he said in the stoning, but notice what he sowed in his stoning. They cast him out of the city, verse 58, and stoned him, and the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul. It has been said, if Stephen hadn't prayed in his dying, Paul probably wouldn't have been saved to preach the gospel. It was something that Paul could never get away from. Acts 22 and 20. Listen to what Paul says. And when the blood of the martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by and consenting unto his death, and kept the raiment of them that slew him. And he said unto me, depart, for I will send thee far hence unto the Gentiles. So here, as we see in the context of that, it was through the witness of Stephen that Paul, one of the reasons I believe Paul was drawn to Christ, because he saw in this man Christ's likeness. This is not on my notes, but I just feel a thumb on my back tonight. Let me ask you this. How do you respond to criticism? How do you respond, maybe not to physical stoning, but to words that wound and hurt and cut? How do we respond? It may be there's a Saul looking on, seeing how we will respond. And let us respond in a way that is Christ-like. And that doesn't come automatic, but it's as he fills us with this Spirit. As we walk in the light and walk with him, he can give us that grace. Stephen stood courageously as they stoned him. Perhaps he had heard the words of Jesus, fear not them which can kill the body, but are able to kill the soul. Maybe he was foretelling the words of Paul, that to live is Christ, but to die is gain. G. Campbell Morgan said that those who have died for the truth were not made martyrs for their dying. They died because they were already martyrs. Persecution never makes martyrs. It only reveals them. And so in light of what we see in God's word, and in this day of shallow, half-hearted commitment, my challenge to you tonight, the challenge to my heart as well, as God has preached this sermon to me first, is that we will be committed followers of Jesus Christ. 100% committed to him and to his church, and to extend and advance the kingdom of God. That's what it's all about. Extending his kingdom. We don't do that through shallowness. We don't do that through half-heartedness. We do that through devotion and dedication and commitment. Amen. How about it tonight? Are you committed? Are you committed? 100% fully committed to whatever God has for you? Let's be committed. Let's be devoted. Let's do what we can with the help of God to extend and advance his kingdom. Let us stand. You've been a wonderful crowd to preach to tonight. Thank you for your attention. And let's go from here. Not forget the message. You forget the preacher all you want. That's fine. But don't forget the message. What God has for us tonight. Brother Fry, would you dismiss us in prayer?
Lord, we thank you for this Lord's Day. You've given us once again. We thank you for the truth we're preached tonight. Yes. And anointing. We pray you to help us be committed Christians to you, Lord. And help us to do better in these areas, we pray. Yes. Lord, give us a new vision. We pray in some of these areas that each one of the person needs, Lord. We pray that you with each of us we go from this place, and help us to be a light to the world out there that needs you so desperately. We give you the praise.